Thank you, everybody, for coming, being part of this beautiful remembrance.
Just let me know when you want me to start, Angela.
Yes, I will. Thanks. So this is the 20th anniversary of Tooker's passing. It's still very rich to celebrate him. And the first 10 years after he passed, we did in-person memorials for him. And they were really beautiful events, and family and friends gathered every year on the anniversary of his passing. And then after the 10 years, we just stopped doing them for whatever reason. They're so painful for me to do, and they take work. So we stopped after 10 years. And so now we're in Zoom days, and it makes it so easy to gather people together. And it seems so obvious that we should have an event that brought people from across the country, from Tooker's past, so many chapters in his life. So there's people from BC, Alberta, Ontario, Quebec, a couple of different states, and maybe more. That
I
Layla, where
found
are
one in.
you? I'm not sure where you are.
Yeah,
I'm not
she's
sure where you are,
really nice of you.
but there's people from around the continent. I'm so happy to see you all in preparation for this and planning the event and reaching out to people and inviting them to share stories. This past week has just been such a meaningful me week for me to remember the past, spend time on the website and reading old stories. That I really appreciate everybody for participating and just being here and remembering it and making this a joyful event. I don't want this, I might blubber, and that's, Shannon will keep the agenda moving along. And there's so many of us that want to share stories that let's just like get right onto it. And thank you for being here. We are recording it. We will post it after. I will send out a link to the recording so you can share it with your friends and you can watch it on your own time. So thank you, Shannon, and the other people that are helping facilitate tonight's event. Over to you, Shannon.
It's a pleasure. Do you want to light your candle, Angela? Oh, it's already lit. Okay, if anyone else wants to light their candle, this is just creating a sacred container. So I think Angela already said that obviously there's lots of emotion every year and all the time thinking about Tooker. She wants us to also just mostly be joyful in celebrating his legacy, his impact, and our community that still lives on, that knew him. So the tone is joyful and also sacred, both of those things. So if you want to light anything to create the sacred part of the container, you can join me now in doing that. Yes, Tooker, thank you for the light, incredible light you brought to our world and our lives. And on a totally different tone, you might have a bike bell. You're muted, Ange. This is a brand new one. I haven't even put it on my bike yet. So we'll have some, we'll unmute if you have a bell or if you just want to make any various sounds later on, closer to the end of the day. We'll unmute and celebrate. Tukara was always inviting us to make some noise with our bells. So that'll come later. And Lynn Adamson has generously offer to help set our sacred container also with an acknowledgement. Thank you, Lynn.
Thank you for the opportunity to share with you all. And I just want to say, Angela, we all want to give you a hug right now. Big hug. You can feel it coming your way. I would just like to say that together we acknowledge the land we are gathering on, and it's different places for different people in this gathering tonight. And I will talk about the territory that I'm on, and you can certainly pop in the chat something about the territory where you are if you like. The land that I'm on tonight is the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississauga of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, the Wendat people, and it's home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people in the city of Toronto here. When European settlers arrived, they entered into treaties with the Indigenous peoples, but those treaties were not just, and they were not honored. We live on this land as a legacy of the bad faith of many agents of the colonial government. We bear the responsibility to redress the harms caused and to work to build right relations. We give thanks for the Haudenosaunee Confederacy for the seventh generation principle. And this is something that I know Tooker would have embraced. I'm sure he embraced it. That requires the decisions we make today result in a sustainable world seven generations into the future. The Haudenosaunee are taught to respect the world in which they live. We live as we are borrowing it from future generations. The seventh generation principle can guide us in building green, affordable housing, getting neighborhoods off our dependence on gas, supporting affordable, reliable transit, more bike lanes, and driving cars less, supporting and protecting the farmland and wetlands around us and our ravines and parks. In Toronto, I'm sure there are places like this where everyone is locally, but I'll just mention the Indigenous leadership protecting the natural environment in Toronto includes the work of the Indigenous Land Stewardship Circle, a community of elders, knowledge keepers, and community members who share a commitment to healing Indigenous lands and caring for the oak savanna in what is known as High Park. These are lands upon which their ancestors conducted ceremony, grew gardens, hunted, and foraged for food and medicines. We love this place that we live on, and we know Tooker felt so much responsibility and care for the world around him, for all life. And we care for that in the spirit of the ancient covenant entitled The Dish with One Spoon, of which Toronto is a part, and all Southern Ontario, I believe, is included in this. This agreement was between the Haudenosaunee and the Anishinaabe and allied nations to peaceably share and care for all living things in the Great Lakes regions. So no knife, just a spoon, and we just take what we need and share peaceably. I'd like to finish with the inspired words of the beloved Ojibwe writer, Richard Wagamese. How to make a dream come true. Don't focus on the dream, or it will always remain a dream. Instead, focus on the first action you can take to bring that dream a little closer. Then take it. Now focus on the next action and take that. Each step brings the dream closer to becoming reality. Why? Our elders teach that the dream world and the real world operate on the same energy. You link them through the power of choice. Choose action, and the dream moves ever closer to the real. And I'd just like to thank the other people who worked on this land acknowledgement. It's not just mine, but I wanted to share it with you. Thanks.
Thank you, Lynn. I appreciate that your acknowledgement didn't step over the bad faith part. Thank you for that. And that last quote really reminds me of Tooker, of course. moving towards the dream with one action at a time, the next right thing. So thank you. That was a beautiful, beautiful quote and linking to so much of what we're celebrating, I think. I'm going to do 30 seconds of boring admin and just get it done. Okay. And then Angela is going to share a video. So the boring admin, it's not that boring, is that we're planning to go somewhere between 90 minutes and 120 minutes, an hour and a half to 2 hours. Obviously, if you need to leave, please do. You can always say goodbye to us in the chat. I know Zoom's been around for a long time, but if it's new to you, at the bottom of your screen, there should be something called chat, and it will pop open. You'll see people are writing it in it now, thanking Lynn for the land acknowledgement. you can always write something there. If there's a setting there called everyone, which the message would go to everybody. And if you didn't want it to go to everybody, you'll see it drop down and it could just go to somebody specific. So if you wanted to say something to me, like you think I missed something important or whatever, you could do that. Send it straight to me, Shannon. Cameron, Angela's partner, is here and he's helping with some tech stuff. So if you were having a tech difficulty, you could message Cameron directly. So you can use the chat and we'll ask you to use the chat a few times, okay? Also, you can view differently. So in your upper right-hand corner, you can put it on gallery view where you see everyone on one page. There's actually four pages of us now. So you have to scroll along if you want to see all four pages with an arrow on the right-hand side of your screen there. If you want to just see, say Angela was talking or somebody was telling a story and you really want to see them big, you can go to that view and choose speaker view. And then that person talking will be really big. And so you'll be able to see them better if that's what you would like. Okay. So you can play around with that. And I think it's already, I've sort of said that we will be muted unless you're talking. There's just, you know, kids walking by or your dog or whatever. And if there's 91 of us with that, it's just too loud. So if you forget to mute yourself, I will kindly do it for you. Don't take offense. It just gets really loud. So, and then to unmute yourself, if you want to talk, at the bottom left hand of your screen, assuming you're on a computer, there's a little microphone and you can push that. It'll unmute yourself if you want to talk. Did I miss anything? I think that was the main tech stuff to communicate. Ange, did I get it all?
Yeah.
Thanks, Shannon.
Okay, great.
So I would like to introduce the video. It's a 4-minute video. It was shortly after, right after Tooker died, before we even had the memorial service in Toronto. I got a musician reached out to me, Mike Ford, who was actually a very well-known musician in town, played with a few different bands, Moxie Fruvus and some others. And he wrote a song for Tooker and he performed it at the memorial in Toronto, and then recorded it. And then Kelly, a few years later, a really good friend of Tooker's who's on the call, he produced a video with Tooker imagery. So it's on the Greenspiration website, it's on YouTube. Many of you have seen it. It's a beautiful video. Let's remember Tooker with this most fantastic thing.
Yeah, I think the audience.
I took a bike ride yesterday, saw a funny world at play, sun to bike lanes, on a street, saw people in slow down to greet, green boxes next to blue and gray, posters for a car-free day, saw families without a trace of fear and joy in public space. Little power, impulse way, I saw things in a different way, don't let that be seen glad. I'll be seeing Tooker Gomberg never shied away from what had not been tried, with faithful friends there at his side. Showed a sweet turn of tide on Adam's way, and Kyoto not go the way of the dodo, burning passport declarations, buried car commemorations. Robin Hood through town he'd glide, inviting us to ride in the ABC class. When the king of furniture decreed his actions immature, the good took aim at his friend, through the people's gauntlet bound, some folks called the coonery, how accurate they proved to be, or like the clowns of Yapery, his stock in trade was on its day. Sparking fires mirthfully to melt the ice of apathy, no more that be seen. Sometimes statistics only forum, so we perforated dull decorum, energized the public forum. What else can one do but a dull hand, ask yourself and make a list, and throw a spell and clench your fist, for after is an activist. Look up nasty through the mist. Fiction like a lightning flash, strength with humor, banish the moment that we see. I only saw him a couple of times in person where the tower chimes, raging at the climate break, horns are honking, words are rhyming, juggling by a tent for peace in frozen winter without cease. We wish for him eternal laughter, peace of mind in the hereafter. Inspire him as he does we, may we all forever see him. I be seen glad.
While we're there, I just wanted to show you this page. Whoops. This website. So greenspiration.org/Tooker. If you go there, you'll see these various hyperlinks. If you go to the memorial hyperlink, you'll just find all these most beautiful eulogies. So many people wrote under condolences and memories. There's just pages and pages of beautiful things that after he died, I just pulled it all together. And and his letter to an activist, which I think Tad will talk a bit about later. Things that I wrote following his passing. Also, Tooker's collected writings here. So this, again, is under the Tooker button. And this has, you know, 50 or 100 beautiful articles that he written. He was such a prolific storyteller. And these are amazing stories. Inside Ralph Klein's vault, you hear all the details that he wrote about. All the different issues from peace to ATVs to speed across the country, all the different things he was writing about in praise of pieing, when activists were pieing back then. Woody Meets Angela's Hammer is my favorite. It's about living off grid, and so many amazing stories. Just pick one. They're all super fun. When we occupied Kretchen's country home and stapled or push-pinned a series of demands on climate. And that's a story in here about garbage, composting, elections. When we buried the car, there's a story about when we buried a car. Maybe Mez will talk about that in Toronto. Just beautiful stories that I invite you to read about at greenspiration.org/Tooker. Thank you. What a beautiful video, hey? Is that like so emotional? And I don't know, is it just me that finds that such a beautiful, emotional thing to watch?
Beautiful, beautiful.
Not just you. And it still amazes me how Mike Forge like captured his essence in those lyrics. It's just super beautiful. And you'll see that I know the audio was like so Kelly, and thank you Kelly for working on that video, has posted the link there, as well as it's on the page that Angela just showed us, the Greenspiration page. So if you want to hear it at awesome audio later on, you can do that again. Thanks Kelly. Yeah, thanks Keith, got your message there. All right, so we're actually going to do some Tooker trivia. And Angela has partnered up with Tooker's brother, Ben, to create this. And Ange, do you want to introduce Ben?
Just wanted to introduce Ben, thanks.
Yeah.
So Ben, you will notice, looks a lot like Tooker. And at our wedding, my nephew, who was maybe two or three at the time, named Brendan, he saw Ben and Tooker standing next to each other, and he said, "Look, Papa, two Tookers." And Tooker included that in an article, and that's why I'll always remember that. Unfortunately, Brendan's not here today. So over to you, Ben. Lead us in some Tooker trivia.
Okay. I'm going to ask 10 questions, one for each finger. And I'm going to invite everyone to put your answers in the chat bar. You guys remember where the chat bar is at the bottom of your screen? Give me a heads up or not. Okay. You're only going to have 20 seconds to answer per question. I'll read out some of the chat answers, and I'm also going to invite 5 people to give some further information related to the questions before going on to the next question. Everybody ready?
Ready.
Ready. Political careers start at different times in people's lives. The first question is, how old was Richard Daniel Tooker Gomberg when he ran his first election campaign? Time's on, 20 seconds, chat bar.
All right, I see 7, 13, 19, 16, 30, 35, 34, 38, 22, 25.
Okay, the winner is Avram Jacobson. Oh, wait, scroll down, because Avram was close at 9. But if you scroll up a little bit, scroll up. I see someone said 10 years old. That was the year, Jacqueline, you got it, where Tooker won to be mayor of Chamberlain Park, a pocket park in Ville-Saint-Laurent, back in 1965. Thank you for your participation. It's only going to get harder.
Sounds like a good story.
Tooker.
So what was the age?
A second degree.
Sorry, Ben, before the second question, people were like, so what was the age, 10?
He was 10 years old.
Okay, thanks, Jesse. Sorry, I saw that. Okay, 10.
He was 10 years old, and it was the local park near our house. And there's even a picture of him somewhere in the archives of him getting an award from the mayor of Ville-Saint-Laurent.
That's awesome. Sorry to interrupt you. Okay, question two.
Question two. What did Tooker do his university thesis on? 20 seconds. Somebody counting for me?
I'll count it.
Okay, I'm looking for answers. University thesis from Hampshire College, Amherst, Massachusetts. Okay, I'm going to give a hint. It ends in ology. But it's not psychology. It's not sociology. It's not pharmacology. Any takers? It's the important and critical field of science known as garbology. Tooker realized that we're facing a mountain of garbage and did research on that. And with that, I'd like to pass the comments to David Starr, a classmate of his at Hampshire College.
Hey, Ben.
Hey, David. Thanks for joining us.
Sure. Glad to be here. That was, I don't know that I would have gotten it if you hadn't reminded me about ology, but I was there when he was doing his thesis. And, you know, he was reluctant to come back to Hampshire because he had taken a leave of absence for a while. I got to Hampshire in 1975, and I was completely lost. You know, Hampshire is nothing like any place else in the world. And Hampshire has this mentorship system where you have a frog, what they call a frog that's a mentor. And Tooker was my frog. He showed up in my dorm room one afternoon, and I was so relieved to see him because I had no idea how I was going to make it through school. So we ended up living together for a few semesters at Hampshire. And when he came back to Hampshire to finish, I was working at Hampshire, and I had a key to all the buildings on campus because I was working there. And Hampshire, Tooker was immediately inspired when he found out that I had a key. So part of his project was, you know, education. He wanted to teach everybody about recycling and sustainability, and he came up with about 10 slogans, like "Don't be a petrol pig," and everything was signed the Energy Phantom. So we created this superhero, the Energy Phantom, created a costume, and he zoomed around campus on his bicycle and left educational messages in people's rooms and offices. By the end of the semester, I was asked to leave campus as a result of being an accomplice. But we had a great semester, and he inspired me to go into be an environmental sustainability educator. And so that's a large part of what I do today. He started the recycling program in Hampshire in 1974 when he got there. And it has been an inspiration for me all these years. So
thank you, David. Yep. Awesome. The energy phantom. I love it. Thank okay. you. All right, Ben.
Is everybody's thumbs on the keyboard? Everyone ready for the answer to the next question, which is, what and when was Tooker first arrested for? And to make things easier for you, because my late brother was arrested for many things, over many times, over many years. This was in 1977, alongside 1,400 other protesters where the Seabrook, New Hampshire anti-nuclear protest, which I understand is the largest mass arrest for a
Wow.
in U.S. history.
Oh, wow.
So let's move on to question number four, which I'm going to ask, and then I'm going to pass to our younger brother, Avi. What was Tooker's first job? Anybody have any ideas? What was the first job that Tooker had after graduating from Hampshire College and the work that David talked about. Am I seeing any? Let's see now. Bear with me. Okay, Shannon, you got recycling coordinator. Recycling program in Montreal, James, you got it. Very impressed. Very proud of you.
Nouvelle.
Vie Nouvelle, who said that?
Danny.
Danny, okay, well, I'll give it to you. He started one of the first curbside recycling programs in Canada in the late 70s called Vie Nouvelle, translated as old news. Abby, would you help us out and give us some background on that, sweetheart?
I believe it was 1978, February or March. I remember Tooker writing up a grant application last minute, and it turned out to be accepted. It was the first door-to-door recycling program in Montreal. It was in what was then the city of Outremont. It was called Vieille Nouvelle, Old News, and it was picking up newspapers, glass, and metal throughout the city of Outremont. There was a curbside store on Van Horn Avenue, and it went on for many years until I guess the city took over the program throughout the city. But it was the first door-to-door recycling program. Tooker would have been 22 years old when he wrote up that grant application at the forefront almost 50 years ago.
Amazing.
I want to ask if Bert has any recollection of that, since you guys were hanging out in those days. I don't mean to put you on the spot, but you were his housemate or apartment mate in Outremont. If you care to add anything, Bert, we'd be grateful.
Well, I remember going on some runs to pick up the newspapers and the glass that people would put out, and he in this beat up old truck, and that Tooker was quite good at. He kept it running, and he was very dynamic. He was, in my mind, truly, he made things happen. He didn't just talk; he was rhetoric. He was a person of such incredible. He was a master of environmental activism, truly impressive.
And thank you, Bert. We're going to move on.
Yeah.
How many elections did Tooker run for? Give me a number. I don't know. 3, 6, 5, 5, 7. Who said 7? Shannon and somebody else.
David.
David, you guys both win the election prize. You ran for his local park. As mentioned, Edmonton City Council, he lost. Edmonton City Council, he won. Edmonton City Council, he lost. NDP in Outremont, he lost. Mayor of Edmonton, Mayor of Toronto. I think the important thing to say is that even though he ran and may not have won, he ran to give a message to the people, to the politicians, and also through the media. And he was dogged and infatigable in trying to get messages like waste recycling, climate change, energy conservation, transportation, air quality, things that we talk about today that we didn't talk about so many years ago. With that, I'd like to pass it to current Edmonton City Councilor Michael Jantz to talk about Tooker's time on City Council in Edmonton.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me. My name's Michael Jantz. I'm the City Councilor for the U of A area, the White Ave area and Southgate, for those of you in Edmonton or from away, which I think overlapped some of Tooker's turf, so to speak. It's really interesting. Like I never knew Tooker. I knew about Tooker. I learned of Tooker. And, you know, 30 years later, it's so interesting to see, like, our city council has invested $100 million into active transportation, into bike lanes. I mean, this would have been inconceivable without Tooker planting the seed 30 years ago. We now are rolling out three-stream recycling, like including composting, into multi-units and soon across the city. this never would have been possible without Tooker's advocacy. So as well, you know, where Tooker was an advocate for housing and density, and you know, we are seeing Edmonton finally getting on the train around we need to start building up and not building out and consuming farmland. Again, these kinds of seeds were planted by Tooker 30 years ago. So, you know, I just seeing all the names here, many of whom I recognize, and just thinking, you know, in our life, we're here just for but a brief flash, and may all of us be remembered 30 years later for the things that we've done and we've grown to make the world a better place. So I never knew Tooker by face or by person, but his legacy is around City Hall with us every day.
Okay. The next question is the easiest. So as everyone's listening, it's actually a four-letter word that I'd like everyone to say together at the same time. What was Tooker's favorite means of transportation? One, bye. Two, three, loud.
Bye.
Okay, you all got it. Very good. Next, what instrument did Tooker play?
Harmonica.
Okay, next. What was his last arrest?
Kyoto?
G20?
Angela, you want to tell us?
For getting locked in Ralph Klein's vault. So just in terms of a little background, he was living in Toronto at the time. It was post-election. I think it was, you know, 2022 or 2002. And Canada went to Kyoto, agreed to sign Kyoto that was 1997, but they still had to ratify it, and they hadn't ratified it yet. It was 2002. And Ralph Klein was the premier, and he was refusing to sign it. And he was just being a real pain in the ass. So Tooker found this, what he called the lost document. It was a document. It was a provincial government produced report, like a long document that showed that Alberta could actually save money, like a 30% rate of return. If they invested in conservation, they could reduce emissions. Back then, the Kyoto commitment was only to reduce emissions by 6%. And think of it, had we done that then, because now scientists are saying we have to reduce emissions by 50%. So we didn't act then, and we're still not. But anyways, so he tried to draw attention to this lost document saying Ralph Klein needs to support Kyoto. And he couldn't get any media attention. He and a few other activists occupied the front of the Alberta legislature in Edmonton for a week outside in the cold. Then he went to Calgary, where Ralph Klein's constituency office was, went into the mall to his office, went to talk to, you know, to ask to see Ralph Klein. They, you know, Ralph Klein wasn't there. And so after sort of giving the secretary a bit of a hard time, she called the security that, you know, here's a protester and he won't leave. So he walked down the hall, and there was this vault in the hall, and he walked into the vault and closed the door, and he was locked inside this locked vault with that big, he locked himself in. And the story is so mind-blowing that this is the last time he was elected. And so he's in the vault. He pulls out his little cell phone, which was big at the time. He had a list of media. He starts phoning the media saying, I'm in Ralph Klein's vault. And then after phoning some, his phone ran out of power. So he's got lights on. There's a fax machine in the room. He grabs a piece of Ralph Klein letterhead. He writes on the letterhead with scribble of writing, because it was really messy writing, this is Tooker Gomberg. I'm in Ralph Klein's vault. I am protesting Ralph Klein not supporting Kyoto, and I want the media to know about the lost doc. He starts faxing it out because he brought with him a whole list of faxes. He's faxing it out. While he's there, he sees a case of booze. He opens up a bottle, a whole bunch of different kinds of booze. He opens up a bottle of champagne. Then he Then all of a sudden he hears the door going boom, 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 boom. And he holds on to the thing. He's trying not to open it. They open it. They come in a whole SWAT team. They throw him down. They cut off his knapsack. They manhandle him. They frog march him out with his coat over his head. He's talking to the media, but they, anyways, so now he's in jail. While in jail, there's a big swastika on the wall, huge 2 feet by 2 foot swastika. He takes off his pants with the buckle on his pants, and he turns the swastika into a square. And shortly thereafter, the jail security come in, make him take off all his clothes. And not only did they bust him for, break and enter or something, mischief in Ralph Klein's vault, but they also busted him for defacing the property of the jail. So that was his last, that was about a year before he passed. And actually there's more to that, but it's his jail time or his court case was right around the exact same time that he passed away. So No coincidence, but yeah, a lot of sadness there. But that was, it's an example of just how ballsy he was and how he just took opportunities and he just said what needed to be said instead of the issues just getting buried and not being dealt with properly. Mm-hmm. So thank you for that, Ben. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so far you guys have gotten about 6.73 out of 10. I'm very impressed with everyone. I really liked the enthusiasm around the word, four-letter word, the best four-letter word of all, bike, which is a hint for the 10th and last question, which is, what would you consider Tooker's legacy project to be in Toronto?
Mm.
Legacy project in Toronto.
Bike lanes.
Bike lane? Who said Lure that?
Bluer bike lane, Lynn.
Lynn, yeah, very good. The Bluer bike lane, otherwise known as Take the Two.
Tooker, yeah.
Awesome.
Could I address that? I had asked Hamish too, but I see he's not here. So just very briefly, A year after Tooker died, I moved back to Toronto, and a few of us got together over beers and brainstormed a legacy project, and we came up with bike lanes on Bloor. And it's a Bloor Danforth is a long spine east-west that goes all the way from Scarborough to Etobicoke, so it's a huge stretch. And cyclists have been asking for a bike lane on that stretch for 50 years. But there had never been any active campaign. So we started it. We called it Take the Tooker. We printed up Take the Tooker bike stickers. We distributed tens of thousands of them. And, you know, after a couple of years, it morphed into a few different campaigns. But today, there are 20 kilometers of the original Take the Tooker vision along the Bloor Danforth spine.
Amazing.
It's a saga now. It's even out there.
He's got people who got hearts. Dave Meslin is posting links to absolutely everything we're talking about in the chat. Thanks, Dave. our fast researcher there. That's awesome.
And thank you, Ben. What happened to Ben? He just scooted out.
Yeah. Was that the last question? Where did Ben go?
That was the last question anyway, Shannon. So over to you.
Thanks, Ben, wherever you went. That was a great, I did, who learned something in that Tooker trivia that you didn't know? Yeah, me too. That was awesome. Yeah, thank you so much. So we thought we might need some kind of a little stretch by this point, and Angela is going to lead us in something called, am I allowed to say what it's called, or you say what it's called?
It's called the Tooker Swing. So Tooker, you know, he was great when we were doing activist events or something. You know, you want to stretch. And Tooker did what I've since called the Tooker Swing.
And I invite everybody to just do a 2 minute, let's all just stand up. Let's just get our blood moving a little bit. And he just swung it from side to side and you actually slap your ribs. So you're kind of waking up your kidneys and your rib cage and you're just loosening everything up. And breathing and twisting the spine. Oh. Thanks, everybody. The Tooker swing. That's it.
Thanks, Ange.
Little health break.
Yeah, it's great. Great. We are going to hear some more stories. So Angela asked some people in advance who were holding specific chapters.
Shannon, sorry. We missed the word.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The word game. And Zach, a good friend of ours, Zach, is going to lead the word game. Go ahead, Zach.
Hello, I'm Zachary Reuter, and I am an environmentalist, and I am doing this with Cameron as the wizard who will also be facilitating this. So thank you, Cameron. If you've ever heard of a word image, we're going to be making a cloud of images, a cloud image of all the words that you were going to put into the chat box right now, and Cameron will collect them and hopefully be able to put them into the image together. So what we'd like to ask you to do is to think about one word. If you really want to have two or three words, but not a paragraph, and it looks like people are already putting them into that. So we see spontaneous, creative, playful, inspiring, loving, maverick, uncompromising, solar electricity, funny with kids, inspiration, caring, passport, inspiration, playful, family, original thinker, dedicated, prophetic, wow, catalyst, caring, irreverent, gutsy, puppet promoter, seed saver, visionary, hero, bike, fun, refuse to stay in his lane. These are beautiful, courageous, energy, jester. Oh, I really love the jester energy one. Hilarious, one less car, charismatic, trailblazer, clown, truth, funny, thankful, vegan, that's a good one, missed, theatrical, darling, greenspiration, bury the car, brilliant, devoted, ride on, present, cyclist, mischievous, loyal, boundary pusher, leader, trailblazer, adorable, great brother, it's very sweet, a short giant, inspiring, renaissance man of social change, friend, undaunted, never stop, Velorussian, mensch, stubborn, visionary. These are so good, everyone. Loving, world changer. So we're going to hopefully get these all into one image for everyone that everyone can take and that we can put on a little writing that I'll be able to do kind of summing up this evening, for anyone who missed it or anyone who wants to come back to it, iconoclast. Okay, so all these words together make me think about how Tooker had the bravery and the courage to look into the future that we are living now. We need to protect, nurture, inspire, and care for the Tookers in our life and the Tookers in the world and our own Tooker inside. So often we hear about how certain things are outside the realm of what we consider realistic, But I think that as time goes on, what may not be realistic, you know, now, has actually become the only realistic way of having a future on this planet and reconnecting with this planet. So what I would invite everyone here to do would be to just put their hand over their heart and drop into your heart. Take a deep breath. Inhale and exhale. And what I'm going to ask you to do is to think about the healing that we need to do outside of us collectively, and to summon the courage that Tooker showed everyone in his life and our world, and be inspired by that, not only in our actions outside of ourselves, but use that same courage that Tooker showed us to heal the things that we need to heal inside and to take care of ourselves. I believe, as someone who's kind of followed along a similar trajectory as Tooker, that as far as we can go outside of us to heal the world and heal ourselves, we can go inside. And when we go inside and we do the healing of the things that we need to heal, that's when we can really resonate in our truth and in our hearts. And that's when the change can happen. We've tried everything. Tooker tried everything. And now I think we owe it to ourselves to cherish the memory of Tooker and use that as an inspiration to heal ourselves and the world. And I'm doing this with you all, and we're doing it right now. Thank you so much, Angela, for inviting me to speak. It's truly an honor. And to all the people that I recognize here who are friends or friends I have not yet met, this is a very beautiful moment. And thank you so much. And I can't wait to see what image comes from all of these words. And it will be a portrait of Tooker and a portrait of everyone's view of him. And it will be so beautiful. Thank you so much. And personally speaking, I know Angela has been having a really tough time, a really, really tough time over the past few weeks. But her activist spirit in putting together this event for all of us and you all attending means so much to her. It is so beautiful to do this for her, for you to show up. And you don't know what it means to her and how this will fuel her in her continued work that she did with Tooker, that she continues to do every day. So thank you so much, Angela. And thanks everyone for coming. We have 102 participants. So that is just blessed. Thank you so much.
Beautiful, Zach. Thank you. Thank you for saying that. And for reminding us all how our presence matters for each other, for remembering Tooker, and also for Angela, and marking this anniversary. So thank you. So back to what I was saying a few minutes ago. Angela had asked a few people to speak just based on them holding important pieces of the puzzle. And so we were going to do that now and then give everyone a chance to speak in one form or another who wanted to after that. So what I just want to say is that everyone who's about to speak knows a lot about Tooker and has a heart-centered story to tell. And yet we only have so much attention to sit and listen. So I'm going to ask people to be really brief. I'm going to ring a little bell at 3 minutes. If you have to finish the thought, great, but I'd love you to wrap up
2 minutes, Angela's saying. Okay, 2 minutes. I know the stories are worth more time than that, but just to keep it moving along and so that everyone gets to participate would be great. So yeah, please don't take that as any commentary on the quality of your story, okay? All right, great. So choose your finest words. Yes, exactly. Thanks. That's a great way to put it. Choose your finest words. So first, we have David, who was going to kick us off.
Me, David?
Yeah.
Yep. There's several Davids here.
Oh, sorry. Yes, you.
hi, I'm David Boroditsky. I'm in Edmonton, Alberta. I probably met Tooker in 1989, around the time of his first unsuccessful campaign for city council. He was a member of a group of progressive candidates known as the Clean Slate. At the time, I was living and working in a very funky old building known as the Multipurpose Rumpus Room that was on the outskirts of Edmonton's downtown core. So besides having awesome parties, my two business partners and I were doing awesome high-tech stuff at the time, like scanning, laser printing, faxing, photocopying, desktop publishing, and that kind of stuff, because, you know, email, the internet, and smartphones were far in the future. In January of 1991, Operation Desert Storm, aka the Gulf War, began, and within minutes, a protest encampment known as the Peace Camp was set up in front of the federal building, a couple of blocks up Jasper Avenue. And the camp was set up very strategically on top of the ventilation ducts for the underground parkade. So even though this was January, there were tons of people camped out there. So being a couple blocks up the road, and much to the chagrin of my business partners, I volunteered our space and resources to aid in supporting the Peace Camp. And at Tooker's urging and participation and encouragement, we started publishing a weekly newsletter called the Peace Times. I think Tooker probably came up with the name Peace Times. By that spring, the Peace Camp had disbanded. My roommates and business partners had departed, and I was left with a 6,000 square foot building and monthly expenses. Tooker and Angela were very strategically able to see the awesome opportunity before them, to nurture an activist space and a community hub. And they offered to cover the costs of the building in exchange for, you know, me sharing all the stuff in the space. And they let me continue to do my nightly sleep research in the basement. The building became known as EcoCity. That was the name of the not-for-profit group that had been set up. It really became, you know, a really magical space. I'm a bit hazy on some of the details and the sequence of events, perhaps owing to the omnipresence of a beer keg and an industrial cappuccino machine in my kitchen. But, you know, there was a couple of years there where there was just so much happening. It was the center of the activist community and the social justice movement in Edmonton. We had, you know, there were the recurring all-ages punk rock gigs on Friday nights with the, you know, the 14-year-olds coming and standing on the couches and then running away to catch the last bus, you know, to help pay the rent. There was so much music and art there. And at the time, it was probably the only smoke-free space. You could go and have a beer and listen to a band and not get choked out by smoke. It was an activist hub.
2 minutes, by the way. So just...
Okay.
Thanks.
There was a compost manufacturing, composters. We manufactured, and you know, there were a dozen people working there, and we were making and selling composters and worm composting. The energy was electric. There was just so much happening, and hundreds of people and dozens of groups all intersected with that space. Personally, I didn't realize at the time how rare Tooker's character and abilities were, but I'll always cherish the time that I was able to work with him and appreciate how much the trajectory in my life was immeasurably improved by that time. Thank you. And there's a lot of Edmontonians here that were there in EcoCity there at the time. on the call, and it's really nice to see you all here. Thank you.
And just to add, David, there was Eco City Society, which was the nonprofit environmental organization that hired everybody and paid the bills. But there was the party room, which was called the Rumpus Room. And that's where all the events were hosted, the smoke-free party space, the Rumpus Room. That was great. Thanks, David.
Amazing. Thank you. Next up, I have Keith Wiley.
My name's Keith Wiley. I live in Nelson, BC now, and I'm an environmentalist and a bike rider. And I see that Dave Boroditsky was wearing, and hi, David, because I was in the Rumpus Room and I had many great times there, and it was very inspiring in Edmonton. I met Tooker and Sally Eisenman, I think shortly after they came to Edmonton from Montreal, actually, in the 1980s. But David was wearing his Thai t-shirt that was painted by my sister-in-law, Michelle Kelly, which I remember as well. And this was produced, I think, in the third campaign, Tooker Gomberg for city council. Took her around for city council. I thought, you're crazy, Tooker. And he won, you know? And that's not the only time. Tooker was an inspiration to me all the time. And his constant energy and his constant commitment to what was most important. I was so admirable when you and Tooker set up the peace camp outside the federal building during the war. I came and brought you food. I was just so proud of you and so appreciative. Tooker locked himself to a truck that was hauling equipment up to the tar sands. Tooker did what was most important, when he ran for City Hall, I thought, it's never going to happen. But at City Hall, he rocked the boat, and the powers that be and the wealthy people hated Tooker, and they went after him, as hard as they could, and they played dirty as they could, and they went after him because he refused to wear a tie, and the tie is the ultimate symbol of white male patriarchal rulers. And I was so proud of Tooker for refusing to wear a tie, but I had to admit I did wear this t-shirt and I wore this tie, but only that one. I can't wear the t-shirt anymore. I'm like, David, you're incredible. My t-shirt shrunk and I grew, but I can't wear it anymore. Tooker inspired me. I had a very good job in Edmonton. I was making good money. I loved it. I quit. I left to become a full-time environmentalist here in Nelson, BC. And this has a lot to do with the commitment and endless energy of my friend Tooker Gomberg.
Wow. Keith, did you wrap up? Because literally the two-minute timer just went off.
Dumb luck.
Thank you. All right. So we're going to take a pause in the speakers so Cameron can share this word mosaic now. Yeah. Are you ready, Cam? Aww. Beautiful. Gorgeous. Thanks, Cam. We could probably send that out to everybody that registered too, if you wanted to see your words represented in there again. Yes, I see some thumbs. Okay, we'll do it. I'm volunteering you, Cam. Often. Thank you. Fabulous. Fantastic. All right. These are great stories and all coming from a time before I knew Tooker. So I'm really appreciating them. I have next Gordon Howell.
Hello.
Hi.
So you want me to share a little bit of a story about Tooker and me?
Yeah.
Well, he changed my life quite considerably, actually. So I'm in Edmonton. I'm a professional engineer. I design and develop solar electric systems. and I've been working with solar electricity exclusively since 1941. No, since 1977, 41 years. 83, 41 years. And I'm one of the pioneers in Canada. So I'd been working at it for a number of years. And in he was alderman in the city of Edmonton. I've told this story many times. And he wanted Edmonton Power, who at that time was the Edmonton Power was a department of the city of Edmonton, and it sold and distributed and generated electricity for the city. And so he, being an alderman, and the city owned Edmonton Power, so he wanted Edmonton Power to put a solar electric system on the roof of City Hall to energize the lights in his office. And at that time, there were probably about 10 grid-connected solar electric systems in the whole of Canada. And so he advocated, I'll use a nice word, he advocated strongly to City Council and to Edmonton Power that they do this. So then David Lewin, at some point, the Vice President of Sustainable Development, got his manager of sustainable development, Joel Nodelman, to look at this technology called photovoltaics or solar electricity. And so Joel Nodelman looked in the Yellow Pages in those days, that's what we had, and found my listing for my company there. And so he phoned me up at the end of June of 1994 and basically said, hey, do you know anything about solar photovoltaics or solar electricity or solar PV? And I said, yes, I'm working in the area. I was monitoring the performance of 14 off-grid systems across Canada for Natural Resources Canada. So he got all excited that I was in Edmonton in his backyard. So he came over the very next day and I showed him a whole pile of pictures of the projects I was working on. And he said he wanted to do a project for Edmonton Power. So I put up my hand quickly and said, well, I've always wanted to put a solar electric system on the roof of my house so that I can live and work with the technology that I was consulting in, because I had a home office, which is what I have now. And
that's your 2 minutes, but Phil, finish your sentence, Gordon.
Okay. And so that led into a project where Edmonton Power hired me as a professional engineer to put a solar electric system on the roof of my house. And it was the 12th grid-connected solar electric system anywhere in Canada of any size, and the first one west of Thunder Bay, and the fourth one on a house in Canada. So I had to fight Edmonton Power to do it. I have fought a lot of the other electricity companies in the province. I've been one of the people that have opened up the electricity grid in Alberta for anybody to do this. And so right now there's about 4,000 systems in Edmonton and 18,000 systems in Alberta. And there's now utility scale ones in Alberta that these days are about generating about 1% of Alberta's electric energy annually. But there's $32 billion worth of private unsubsidized investment going into solar in Alberta these days, that within 5 years, we would expect to get about 40% of our provincial electric energy on an annual basis from the sun. And on any sunny day, any sunny hour of the year, 5 years from now, if all these projects go ahead, we'll be getting something like 130% of our provincial electric energy from the sun on those hours. That's what's happening. If we get rid of the stupid government that's here now, of course.
Fantastic story of the origin story. Thank you, Gordon.
So he changed my career entirely because of his persistence and perseverance. And for that, I am extremely grateful. Mm.
Incredible. Thank you.
He would be so delighted these days to see what's happening in Alberta because of the mustard seed that he planted.
Thank you. Andrew, you wanting to get in there? No, you're good? Okay, great. Thank you so much, Gordon. So next I have Greg Allen. Is Greg here? I'm not sure if I saw Greg.
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, there you are. Hi, Greg.
Hello, Shannon. It's so delightful to meet all these people that have connected through Tooker. I'm amazed. I know Gordon. I know a number of you, and but I hadn't known the connection. So I had written down what I thought would be a succinct enough for a 2-minute talk about how I received the first light from Tooker. 25 years ago, Jack Layton asked me to join him for beers to meet Tooker and Angela. And I knew them through the Greenspiration Tour communiques and was aware of Tooker's provocative approach to politics as an Edmonton city councillor. Jack and I were working together on Green Catalyst Group to activate Toronto City Council around deep lake water cooling, Toronto Water and Energy Retrofit Program, TREC, wind turbines, zero waste, etc. So I was very excited to meet new activists coming to Toronto, and I was not disappointed. Running for mayor without a budget and relying on attracting an army of volunteers was definitely ballsy, and I couldn't stay away. I went to Tooker's campaign office to see how I could help, and found the space filled with young, poor, buoyant volunteers awaiting instructions for the next actions to gain public and press attention on poverty and environmental issues unprecedented in this staid city of my birth. Further on down the road, I remember going into Metro Hall and finding corpses lying on the entry steps, as though exposed to a chemical warfare attack. There he was, making the point that air pollution in Toronto is killing asthmatics and elderly in droves. At that moment, the Metro assigned keeper of the peace was manhandling Tooker into custody for being prone, or as it turned out, disturbing the peace. I followed the assailant into the building and made him aware that I was observing and reporting his actions. Several months later, Tooker asked me to attend his trial, and we were successful in convincing the judge to quash the charges. The last time I was with Tooker was after an extended period of his withdrawal. Angela called to ask me to meet with him. His sadness was deep, but we did have a conversation about the essential nature of our actions and commitments to healing the world and ourselves. The depression so many of us feel about our times must be countered by the good we see in each other. Our deep sadness is not a disease to be treated by so-called psychoactive pharmaceuticals. It is the result of our love of life meeting loss of hope. Our communion of goodwill and gratitude is the cure.
That's beautiful. So moving. Thank you. Well said. Thanks for adding that part about depression and the understandable depression of separation and loss of hope. Thank you, Greg. Beautiful. Yeah. All right. I have next on my speakers list, Dave Meslin.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Great. Hi, Shannon. Hey, Angela. Hey, everyone. Tooker and Angela shaped my life in so many ways. I was in my 20s when I met them. I was a young, idealistic activist, but I felt a pressure that I had to let go of that and grow up, because that's what you do. And to meet Angela and Tooker, who were older than me, but seemed to have even more optimism and more energy, and to know that you could live as activists as adults was the most incredible, mind-blowing thing I'd ever seen. And now I'm 50 years old, and I'm still an activist. And I wish Tooker could see what I'm doing now. So much of my work was shaped by his spirit and his tactics and his vibrancy. I'm going to share two stories really quick. One of the first projects I did with Tooker and Angela was mentioned earlier. It was the burying of the car. Tooker wanted to bring attention to the 100th year anniversary of the death of the first pedestrian fatality. And this is actually very close to me now, because my girlfriend was hit by a truck 2 years ago and almost passed away. So Tooker, being Tooker, didn't just put out a press release or write a report. He decided to memorialize all the people who've died since that first pedestrian fatality by having a funeral for the car and actually burying a car. I didn't understand why you'd put so much effort into an event until we did it and we buried my car. Angela and Tooker were looking for a volunteer crazy enough to give up, donate their car. So I donated my car. We buried it on the front lawn of a home in the East End. And what I learned that way, and I still use this tactic today, I teach this tactic, is that if you do something extravagant and theatrical and performative, you will reach more people. It's so powerful. So there was the 10 of us wearing suits and ties, because it wasn't city council, it was a funeral. And Tooker read a eulogy to the car, but facing us was another wall of people with cameras and notepads and audio recorders. And we had a half-page article in the newspaper, lots of radio coverage. And I realized that theater, performance, creativity are the ingredients to successful activism. And I've been living that way of life now for decades. I'll do another one really quick. I wish I could tell the story longer because it's all the details that are so magical, but it's actually pretty good too as a 20-second story. I used to organize these parties called Reclaim the Streets in Toronto, and we would illegally shut down the road and have a dance party. And once we did it in front of the Stock Exchange, and Tooker had come to one of our earlier meetings a month or two before and said, "Hey, I've got a crazy idea. What if we covered the road in grass?" And I was like, "Sure, Tooker, it's a good idea, but how the hell would we do that?" He's like, "Can we do it? Can we do it?" I'm like, "Okay, fine, you can do it." Totally forgot about it. In the middle of this party in June, this dump truck shows up full of rolls of sod. I didn't know it was going to happen. It just showed up. Tooker jumps on top of the truck and he's throwing them down. And within 2 or 3 minutes, the entire road was covered in grass and people were dancing barefoot on the street in front of the Stock Exchange. I just want to close by saying that Tooker was so ahead of his time, and all the things that he was ridiculed for having radical ideas that were, you know, too extreme, most of those ideas have proven to be mainstream now. And I think being ahead of your time and being a social justice and environmental prophet who's prepared to say what no one else wants to say can be incredibly lonely and incredibly devastating. And as we heard in Edmonton, it makes you a target, a political target, a social target. It's a huge sacrifice he made for us, but his legacy lives on in our lives, in my life, and I miss him so much. And when he passed away, I was really scared. I thought that the dream wasn't true, that you can't live as an activist and get through life. But as of this year, I'm actually older than Tooker ever got. And I'm sharing that because my mental health hasn't always been great. And I'm sure lots of people in this room have also struggled with mental health. And I just want to tell all of you to like talk about it, talk to your friends, don't give up. You can be a Tooker, you can be optimistic, idealistic, angry, it's a great way to be if you can channel that anger into creativity. And that's what Tooker taught me, how to turn anger into hope. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. Getting lots of thumbs up and yeah, agreement there, Dave. Yeah, beautiful. And yeah, great stories. And there's a very active happening in the chat, thanking people for their stories, adding things. And yeah, so if you want to see the impact of what you're saying, check the chat out. There's lots of gorgeous, generous sharing there, and people even adding other stories. The time Tooker dumped a truckload of coal on the sidewalk. Thanks, Gordon. So yeah, lots of great additions there. Thank you. Thanks, Dave. We have three more people that are going to speak before we open up the floor a little bit. So next I have Anthony Hall.
Anthony, are you there? If you're talking, you must be muted. If you're not talking, that would be good to know too.
Okay.
Oh, there you are. We got you. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, Tony Hall from Lethbridge, Alberta. Tooker spent quite a long time in a one-year period back and forth into Lethbridge, Alberta. And it started when I was trying to get a department up and running called Globalization Studies. And Tooker came to Lethbridge to help me do it and to use all the new tech. And within a couple of weeks, he was at a demonstration in New York. And this was 2002, broadcasting from a coffee shop in New York in amidst some kind of demonstration. And this had never really been seen before, that you could be in a classroom talking to somebody in New York. You know, it's very normal now, but at that time he was very cutting edge. He's the first person I saw with a video plugged into his laptop computer. We met getting out of Orsonville Penitentiary. We were both inmates in Orsonville Penitentiary, where they were working on the free trade area of the Americas. And shortly I met him in Toronto and met Ange and started to, you know, find out his larger story. When he walked around in the streets in Toronto, everybody says hello to him. He stayed here for a long time, on and off, and he became very enamored with like the University of Lethbridge. He had a whole concept for the University of Lethbridge, whose motto is "Let there be light." And he really did have a discussion going in the university about making the whole university kind of built around experimentation and research in energy and such. You know, there was a lot of people in the industry coming around noticing this. He wanted to take over the American Hotel, and this ancient legendary hotel in Fort McLeod, amidst all these windmills, and transform the hotel into some kind of education center on energy. You know, he had, you know, all these visions and ideas. We did a film called Teepee and the Turbine out of this. It's still around. You can still see it. I could just go on and on, but he was just constantly, as you know, saying startling things, always traveling around with his video. Kyoto Protocol was, you know, we were trying to show in Alberta, you know, we're not all rednecks, and we could embrace the idea of Kyoto Protocol and all of that. We did research into the PR agencies for Ralph Klein. Last I saw of him in that period, he was heading off to New York to follow Ralph Klein, who I guess was negotiating a lot of the tar sand deals. And so he got into some kind of issue in New York. He was carrying my cell phone. I just slipped him my cell phone as he left. Anyway, Ange, thanks for including me. And there is the Tooker Gomberg Award at the University of Lethbridge, which still exists. So you should be aware that he's been recognized in this academic way, which he definitely deserved. He was an educator par excellence.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And sorry I called you Anthony and not Tony.
No, that's I'm both.
Okay, great. It
took me a while to figure out as a kid that they're right? The same name.
Thank you so much. All right, next I have Kelly.
Oh, hi.
Hi.
Okay, we're on. I need to, just change my view here for a quick second. So I want to talk about the Toronto election, Gomberg for Mayor 2000. It was a big year. I had connected with Tooker in March when he had come out, as Keith reminded us, for the lockdown on some tar sands equipment on its way to Fort McMurray. In May of that year, we were together at the Ruckus environmental activist camp in just outside of Calgary. In June, together on the streets of Calgary for the World Petroleum Congress, where Tooker was arrested because he got too close to Suncor from the previous action back in March. And then come fall, I was on my sister's couch and I saw that he was running for mayor of Toronto. It came on the news, so I called him up to congratulate him. And right immediately, he's like, well, you should come out and help me. I'm like, well, I guess I'm not really doing anything, sure. So I went out there and tried keeping up with Tooker and Angela for a good solid 2 months. And the man definitely indefatigable. very hard to keep up with. I don't think he actually slept. Angela had mentioned that, you know, he'd wake up at 5 a.m, but honestly, I don't think he did sleep. I've got a video that I'm going to leave a link for. And my favorite clip of the video from that election campaign was Tooker at 3 a.m. It's pouring rain outside. We're at their flat on College Street in Toronto, which is also the campaign headquarters. It's pouring rain. Tooker's like, oh, I got this idea. Come follow me outside. So we'll follow him out in the pouring rain. And he does this great 1.5-minute bit on water and water conservation and Lake Ontario and other amazing environmental initiatives. Anyways, Tooker, he was such a hard worker, keeping up with him around town. He was such a jester, so much fun, throwing down the gauntlet at Mill Lastman, getting manhandled out into the cop car before that or after that. I think we caught Mill Lastman up in Scarborough, and Tooker again. He got manhandled by security, and at the time, Tooker was carrying one of many props. He always had props. He had a rubber chicken. It was brilliant. And he's holding up that rubber chicken as if to, you know, to say that Mel Lastman was a chicken for debating him. And these security guards grab Tooker, and he had bruises on him after. And they're grabbing him. They grab his chicken, and Tooker's yelling, "Get your hands off my chicken!" It was absolutely hilarious. Love that, man. The night before the election, I was with Tooker and Jean. I think, Jean, you're here in on the call. We had broken into... my goodness, which hospital was that? Angela, help us out. An old hospital, now shuttered. It's probably still sitting there with doing nothing, being heated. Anyways, we broke into that as a way to sort of symbolize the need for housing. And the next day was the election. Just brilliant time. I met many of you because of that election campaign. And that's it. That's my time. Thank you.
Kelly, I know you have so many stories. That was very restrained. I love the image. Let go of my chicken.
Check the comments for a clip.
Thanks, Kelly. Yeah, thanks for everything you've been posting there. Thank you so much. Okay, and last but not least, I think, on the prearranged speakers list is Tad.
Hello, everybody. So many old friends here, and so good to see you all being brought together in this way. And may any bad blood that exists between anyone here be soothed by the sweetness of our coming together. You know, in Scottish tradition, you'd put a cairn, you'd make a pile of stones when somebody died. And it strikes me there's three metrics you could use of a well-lived life. Number one, how many stones do people bring? Number two, the quality of the people who bring the stones. Number three, how many years do people keep bringing those stones for? And that's a well-lived life for Tooker. And the Mexicans say there's three deaths. The first is the death of the body. Second one is when the body's put in the ground. And the third one is when the last person speaks their name. So Tooker ain't quite dead yet in that way. I'd written a song years ago after Tooker died, and I haven't played it almost since. And Angela asked if I'd busted out, so I did, and I've updated it a little bit, so please forgive me. I've had to put Band-Aids on my fingers because I just haven't played guitar in so long, so I'm in that moment, and so forgive me for the roughness of this. So this was written in the days after, with some addendums now. How's that sound? It's okay.
Good, yep.
All right. A note made of loose threads, a bike left behind, the bridge you never managed to cross, spanning before and after that night. The past's weight is light, the future bore the burden of loss. Were your eyes to the bridge, the water or the sky? Were they closed as you made your way down? Did you pivot to grab the railing, miss it by inches? Did you swim or just let yourself drown? Thanks for reaching out, you said. All my words felt like failures. They couldn't return the smile to the clown. Why did the molehills seem so much bigger than mountains to you? Guess we never know what each other go through. Not everything bends, but anything can be broken, and the heart it breaks hardest of all. Even Jesus on the cross said, "Dad, where did she go? I can't hear you anymore at all." This untimely rip, the sudden separation, this double-edged dagger in your grasp. It cuts you free from this life, but widowed your wife. How did something so small get so vast? Why did the molehills seem so much bigger than mountains to you? I guess we never really know what each other go through. We're 20 years on, still can't believe that you're gone. I was with you in Toronto last year, and then the doctors and the cops, the media cyclops chopping blocks. They strike the shepherd to scatter the flocks. So fuck the TikTok blue light box, the sleepless nights, Pandora's box, and hope escaped like a midnight fox. Harmonica jukebox, pipeline stops. You deserved the mountaintops and better help than you ever got. We deserve another 50 years before it all stopped. I wish I'd listened more when we talked. 20 years on, still can't believe that you're gone. I was with you in Toronto last year.
So beautiful, so touching. Thank you. Sounded great, Ted. Great to remember that we don't always know what each other are going through. I see your hand, Robert. We have one more thing to do, and then we'll do an open mic, okay? So I'm just going to ask you to wait one second. Is that all right? And I see some hands. We're not quite ready for hands yet because I made a mistake.
How do you do this?
So we have Ross Campbell to say one more thing, and then I'm going to take hands, okay? So just hold on for one sec. Ross, take it away.
Hello there, everybody. Nice to see people, and I've known Keith and the Bardischke brothers. Angela, lovely to be with you. I had the privilege. I'm going to cut it short, but it's a long story. I'm going to talk fast. And I had the privilege of working with Tooker at the Energy Conservation Branch, which we worked for the Department of Energy. It had an Energy Conservation Branch, provincial that is, although they discontinued it after we left. As one would expect the conservatives to do at the time. But however, we traveled around the province in a van full of puppets and other paraphernalia to schools, elementary schools, all around the province, rural and urban. We had a lovely time. It was a perfect job for Tooker, teaching the kids to save energy and recycle, et cetera, et cetera. I knew that I got the job because of him. He had it first, and he told me the opening. We traveled in teams of two, and I was usually with Tooker. So we had a wonderful time together. It was a lot of fun because it was a perfect job for Tooker. And, you know, he was wonderful children. I wanted to bring this out. Everybody saw his teaching abilities with everybody in general, adults, etc. He was his serious side was very effective as a speaker. But he was wonderful with children. The warmth that came out and the humor that came out with children is something that everyone here should know about. And I'm sorry I was so late in telling everybody, but it's important to realize what a wonderful heart he had and how effective he was at what we did. I'll give you a brief idea of what we did. We went into elementary schools. We had three shows. One was for the ones in grade ones and twos. It was a very simple show. It was two puppets, Sunny and Silly. And you can imagine Silly made all the mistakes of wasting energy, and Sunny corrected Silly. So that was a team show, one puppet with each team member. I skip over the threes and fours for a moment. The fives and sixes were the know-it-alls, and we did skits with them. We had hair pieces and hats, and Tooker was great at putting together scenarios where people had to, and people taught that the kids were know-it-alls, and they often taught each other to save energy because of the way Tooker primed them. But I'll say that I'm saving the best for last. The grade threes and fours were in the middle there, and we had a special, that was not so much a team effort. We all did things separately from the teams. I would sing a song, and Tooker would do some juggling. And of course, when he was serious, he told slightly naughty things to the kids to remember, such as, if it's brown, flush it down. If it's yellow, let it mellow. That was his water conservation. And the kids remembered that one because that was potty humor. And that was a great way that he got through to them. But I want to talk about the glut. The glut was not a team effort. The glut was a handheld puppet. It looked like a cookster with real attitude. Tooker was the guy. I think he must have invented that puppet and developed it before I was hired. I don't know that for sure, but he took to the glut. He was wonderful at the glut. The glut was, he bragged about wasting. He bragged about every kind of waste you can imagine. Tooker had a lot of fun with it. He bragged, and he got the kids, he wanted the kids to waste too. And he said outrageous things to them, and with by himself, with his ironic sense of humor, and he got the kids to come around and correct him about what he was saying. He did it single-handedly. He didn't need remember, the kids were the ones who figured out that that was not the way to go. So he had such fun with it. It was a wonderful thing to witness, and I feel privileged to have been with him. Of course, I knew him later in Eco City. My kids and I had a family band called Locomotion, and we played festivals. We went to Europe and played over there, and we played Eco City. We did a gig at Eco City, which was one of our best gigs. So I loved Eco City, and I was very sad when it met its demise. So that's basically what I wanted to say. I could go on and on about it, but fun working with Tooker, and the kids loved him, as we do.
Oh yeah, we had so many memories of Tooker charming children. Hey, Ange, when you traveled overseas, and oh my gosh, thank you so much, Ross. So I have a proposition. We've been going for an hour and 45 minutes. People did such a fantastic job of being brief. I know it took a lot of restraint, so thank you for that. I'm going to propose, some people are leaving, that's fine. I'm going to propose we go for about 10, 15 more minutes, so we would end at the 2-hour mark. We're going to all end together with some bell ringing and stuff, whoever's left. And so to get as many voices as possible between now and then, I'm just going to, how about a strict 1 minute? And if you can be even shorter than that, bonus. So I have a speaker's list. I can see the order in which people put up their hand here. So I have Robert, James, Jesse, Jean, Christine, and Elin. I'm not sure if I'm saying your name properly, who can correct me. So I'm going to set a 1 minute timer, okay? And I'll ring the bell and let's wrap up with some other great stories. Robert.
It's great. Using Robert's machine.
Oh.
Hi, Angela. Yeah. It very emotional time. We all miss him very much. I've got a beautiful Tooker story. I was working with at the university, putting research together for the climate change in the Boreal newspaper. And a lot of heavy stuff. And one of the things I learned from the Dutch Academy was that eco niches would be destroyed by the ravages of climate change. And that one of the plants that would be affected is coffee. And we're talking about the climate change newspaper. You contributed to it. It was wonderful. Big forest fire on the back. And in it, it was predicted there'd be a transcontinental forest fire, which happened last spring. But anyways, back to the coffee. Tooker was absolutely horrified when I told him about the coffee, because Tooker loved coffee incredibly. So I said, Tooker, I'm sorry I told you that. Can I get your refill? I said, yes, please. He loves his coffee. So I remember his bicycle, coffee, and eating samosas at the Rumpus Room. Love your mother, too.
Aw, thank you.
Love you. Take care.
Aw, thank you. Beautiful. All right, James.
Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Yeah. So I worked with Tooker as his executive assistant when he was at City Hall. I actually worked on his campaign in 1989 as well. But just a big shout out. I haven't seen Avi and Ben and Chuck and even Angela for quite a while. So like David, so a big shout out to you. Like David, I think Tooker influenced my life in so many ways. I live in a house right now that's net zero, 27 solar panels. I ride my bike all year round. I teach school, so taking on some of his activism as a teacher and hopefully making a difference there. Just a quick story, I could be telling about City Hall, but one in particular that came to mind was his. For people that are not in Edmonton, there's a famous battle that happened in Edmonton over what was called Keeler Road. And when Keeler Road was kind of coming to a head, it had been off again at City Hall in terms of what to do with that road. And when one of the protests kind of manifested itself while Tooker was on council, and he was already a counselor, so it wasn't really appropriate for him to go and protest like everybody else. So when he got there to where the protesters were, instead, in his capacity as city councilor, he ordered pizza for everybody so that they could be fed. So and I remember on the radio talking about the fact that all these people were then eating pizza at the protest, thanks to Tooker. And just to follow that story forward just a little bit, we ended up having a public hearing on the final closure of the road. And if Tooker hadn't been an activist and a counselor and all the other things, he could have been a litigator as well. During the public hearing, one of the proponents to keep this road open was a guy by the name of Brent Mateson, who ends up getting on council later. But Tooker just had this amazing inquiry of him. And I remember him, Tooker, phoning me in my office to get this book that we'd had about Keeler Road. And I didn't know what he wanted for it. So he just said, bring me down that book. I bring down the book. And what Tooker had read in the book was that the Keeler Road had been donated by a Dr. Keeler back in the 1920s or something like that. And then from that premise, he was able to then make the, so he kind of twisted Brent Mateson around and talked about the idea of agreements. And Mateson was on about in his own little spiel saying about how we have to live up to our agreements. The city should, that road was supposed to be open and blah, 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 blah. And Tooker basically built him up, and then basically cut him off at the end by saying, well, Dr. Keeler wanted this road to be donated to the people and not to be a thoroughfare. And Brent Mateson just lost it after that and was just screaming about how the city was, this wasn't Carmel by the Sea, we can't be just all riding bicycles and stuff like that. And long story short, the road, you know, after Mason went off on a tangent and everything else, we ended up getting the road closed, which was really, and afterwards, I remember Tooker just smiling big time to get that that victory, where there was lots of good victories at City Council, but that was one of my favorite memories of that whole public hearing and taking down that pro-Keeler road group. Nice to see all the other familiar faces in the call as well today.
Thank you so much, James. Thank you for that story. So many stories. Oh my goodness. Okay, so I think my list, I 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we really need to stick to 1 minute if we're all going to get in before we wrap up. Okay. So Jesse, I've got you next.
Hi, I'm Jesse Gomberg. I'm Tooker's niece. He was the brother of my father. And he died when I was quite young, so I didn't get to know him in the capacity as many of you did, but I knew him as my uncle, and I loved him very much. Part of the reason I wanted to say something is because my uncle Tooker obviously had depression and took his life, but I also suffer from major depression, and I have also been in the position where I felt like I could no longer go on. And I have since, you know, somebody mentioned healing, and I just really wanted to say something about the power of healing oneself and healing communities, because it's extremely important in my life. I'm doing a PhD on mental illness in the legal profession. And I like to think that my work has been inspired by my own experience, but also I just really wish that I could have my Uncle Tooker to talk to him about some of the issues that I've faced in my life. And I miss him very much. I just wanted to say something. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm so glad you did. Yeah. Thank you, Jesse. I wish you had your uncle to talk to too. Obviously dedicating a whole lot of your life to shedding some light on these, on this same issue of depression. Thank you. I don't know how to properly say your name, but I have JME next. You wanted to read a poem.
Yes, thank you so much. The poem's too long, but I'll read the last stanza. The work of the world is as common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing, well done, has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for the wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn, are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real. And that's by Marge Piercy.
Mm. Thank you so much. Beautiful. Oh, and just want to thank people again for being so supportive and so generous in the chat. Jesse, I hope you can see all the love you're getting there. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for that beautiful poem, or part of a poem. And again, I appreciate your restraint. I have Christine next.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, Jesse, and thank you for sharing. And thank you to Angela for organizing this. I know it was difficult, but it's been meaningful and inspiring. And I'm sorry for no video. I wanted to add to the stories of Tooker. This is just a local Toronto story, like the other ones, the national ones, like they're huge. But just to show how engaged he was, does anyone remember when he occupied DuPont in Bathurst in Toronto? I live just around DuPont. And I don't remember if he gave notice of this or if I just came across it, but he was out there in the middle of these two busy streets with his bike, and he shut the place down for hours. It made the Toronto Star. And I just remember thinking to myself, man, this guy is so inspiring. Climate, bikes, and brave, you know, that he was willing to take on whatever happened. So I just wanted to share that. Thank you.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Christine. I have Elaine now. Again, correct me if I've said your name improperly. I apologize.
Yeah, it's a multiplicity of pronunciations. Thank you. I'm going to talk very fast. I've been thinking for days what I would say about Tooker, and there's so many stories that have been covered, and it would take, you know, easily an hour. So first of all, just to situate myself, Tooker has inspired me and has continued to inspire me. I'm in California. I run the Green Neuroscience Laboratory. We have a Tooker Student Award, and that very much was influenced by Tooker. Jesse, thank you so much for mentioning the self-care. That was, I had a whole section about that, but I'm going to take the road less taken, and I'm going to think about stuff that hasn't quite been mentioned yet, but certainly is here this evening. And it starts with an old joke, and it's because everyone goes like, you know, you say, me and my brother know all the roads in Toronto. And, you know, the person asks you, well, yeah, do you know Euclid? Do you know, obviously, you know, Bloor. And then they'll mention something like Loreleaf. Oh, that's the one my brother knows. And the reason I'm mentioning it is because there's three sort of lessons to it. First of all, you know, a city takes many, many streets and many roads, and Tooker was never afraid of getting on all those roads and bringing them together. That's why I said, you know, he didn't stay in his lane. And to really make progress, we have to understand that these things are all interconnected and we can't just limit ourselves. So it's so great to hear all these stories. The next one is connecting to others, which obviously just by all the squares on the screen, we can see that he did. But specifically the people who are unseen, and Angela was never unseen, but Oriol Varga, who did many of the actions that I took place with Tooker, always reminded me, pay attention to Angela. And Angela back then was doing so much, you know, in terms of her own campaigns and so forth, and teaching at the Free U of T, but now has actually continued his work, not only in anti-nuclear activism, but raising attention to the medical establishment. So all the stuff that Jesse mentioned earlier, that was something that Tooker kind of missed, but, you know, obviously continues because of him, and we need to work on. And in that, to sort of take it to a meta level, the people that I wanted to thank today are two people I don't know. And that's actually Angela's mom, who has sat through several meetings, because Angela still supports me in many ways and some of the stuff we're doing. And Cameron, who I also know makes it possible for Angela to be here. I don't really know them, but I hung out, you know, virtually, or have been able to hang out with Angela, thanks to them. And so thank you. And lastly, the last of the three lessons is we need more jokes. So, you know, people were pretty funny tonight, but, you know, Tooker was consistently almost right up until the end funny. And it melted and broke through all different kinds of things. So I'm so thankful for that. So that's it.
Beautiful. Thank you. More jokes. Okay, I've got Lorna, Jean, Lynn, and Cynthia. Okay, and then maybe we'll end after that. Lorna, you ready?
All right, thank you. Hello, hi, everybody, and hello to all the people who used to live in Sundance Housing Co-op, and hello, Angela. We've got Phil here. We've got Denise in the background. And I wanted to just tell a quick story about children, because our children, there we are, Alex and Kaylee, were so proud when Tooker and Angela invited them to come and have a photo op, because they were going to plant a tree. I think there was two tree planting, and maybe I can be corrected here, but one was in front of our unit, or adjacent to our unit, number 28 Sundance Housing Co-op, and the other was in at the Naturescape at Riverdale School. Mm-hmm. And so our kids felt so proud that they were allowed to come and be a part of that photo op. And so we really, really remember Tooker and Angela, and it's so nice to reconnect with everybody on this call. Thanks very much.
Ah, beautiful memory. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks for an opportunity to share something about Tooker. He was one of a kind and got me connected with Angela, who's been just my lifelong friend. So that's decades now, Angela, that we've been friends, and it's really wonderful. Like 25 years, I think it would be about that by now. And I simply wanted to mention the one action I remember being involved with. I think it was on Huron Street. I think there was some kind of conference going on in a student building right there. And Tooker had a papier-mâché globe of the Earth. And this was in advance of COP. I'm pretty sure this was in advance of maybe when he went to Amsterdam. I think it might have been then. And he had this huge, like huge, okay, like globe. And he lit it on fire, okay, put propellant on it, and lit it on fire. And it just made this huge, you know, it just really exploded. It was a big flame. And actually the police ended up, I guess it was campus police, they showed up, and then they called the police, and then they tried to put Tooker in the police car, but everybody surrounded the police and unarrested him. And I think Jean may want to say even more about that incident. But I just think his boldness and his willingness to do things that were a little bit risky were, you know, was just attracted so much attention to these new ideas that were right in the forefront. You know, we are burning up the planet. We can see it now, all the forest fires and so forth. And he was saying we're doing that back then. And then, of course, when he went to the COP in Amsterdam and he burned his passport, he was showing that again, we're burning up the planet. And so he was prescient and got attention paid to those issues. And we carry on, you know, I wish we could we could embody him even more than we can, but we can certainly reignite that inspiration that we get from him by sharing tonight. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Lynn. Cynthia.
Hi. Hi, everybody. I knew Tooker. I met him in around 1979 when we took a class. I met him in a class at Concordia, and this was a class in environmental studies. The teacher was Fred Nelman, who wrote a book called Anti-Nation: Transition to Sustainability. Now, Tooker was not actually in the class. He just showed up to the class, and he was treated by like royalty by the professor. And there was just like no question at first glance that this was an interesting person. So in this class, the teacher would mention environmental events happening around Montreal, and I would go to them and I would meet Tooker there. So that's how we got to be friends. And we kind of liked each other, I think, but we were never single at the same time, so we were just friends. Here's a cute little picture of us.
Aww.
Friday. with a kitten. So I remember at Darlington, I'll do this fast, the big protest against a nuclear power facility they were building. There's some nice lady from Toronto let everybody sleep in their house, and Tooker slept on the couch sitting up. So apparently that was one of his many skills, to sleep sitting up. And I tried to help with some of his campaigns, although I don't know how helpful I was. But I did have the privilege of visiting Tooker at his family home, and I also became very fond of his whole family. One Christmas Eve, we were visiting, and I lived on Sewell Street, and it was raining and storming and icy, and we decided to go to a midnight mass, and Tooker insisted that we take our bicycles, of course, and so somehow he convinced me to take my bike out, which I didn't wasn't a winter biker. And then he said, okay, now you've ridden your bike in the worst possible weather, you can do it anytime. And I do have a lot of stories, but I just I do some, well, I've done some yoga with Angela, and I told her that, you know, of course I think about Tooker from time to time, often when I'm wasting water. And then she had the, I said, okay, well, no, I shouldn't do that. He wouldn't like that. And then she had that move from yoga that she showed you, that she showed us before, the Tooker. So I have a nice way to remember him along with all of the others.
Aw, I love these little photos. Thank you, Cindy.
Aren't they sweet? Yeah.
So sweet.
My life, as in everybody here, is very much enriched from having known him.
Thank you. Beautiful. I want to check back in with Jean. I see your name there, Jean. Are you able to unmute? I'm going to ask you to unmute and see if that works. Okay. It's not looking like that's working right now, Jean. So, all right.
How are we doing? Right away, I'm still here.
Oh, Jean, is that you?
I was looking at. Yeah. Okay. I can hardly sometimes see images of other people. Sometimes I see nothing. So there's so many stories. Maybe I'm connected to a quarter or maybe even at least half of the stories you took her. At University of Toronto. Trobe and all that, and then the police, the U of T police comes, and we all together unarrested Angela that almost got taken away. Why did they? I forget the why that for him, and I forgot to say that also that building we never renovated, like 10 to 15 of us on Park Avenue in Montreal to become the Rabbinic Ecology Center. I think it took us 2 months. And oh my gosh, in Vancouver they went, Angela and Tooker went to Japan for the Kyoto thing, and when they came back I went to the airport to like say hey, I'm here, but Angela was flying back to Edmonton, so I connected with Tooker, who was doing a slideshow, one in just like collectively run cafe, like Kenya or something. And then he did another conference downtown at the conference center. And then we bicycled all the way to go
we just lost your audio, Jean. I know you said we were coming in and
take the
Oh, we lost you again. Sorry.
I was so amazed. I brought.
Okay, Jean, we can't quite follow along. Maybe come back
to the fiction on us. He was
okay. So, thank you. So here is what I'm going to suggest, because it's 10 after, well, in Toronto, it's 10 after 9. I realize people are all over the place. I'm going to suggest that people are having to leave and saying goodbye, which is awesome and fine. I'm going to suggest we do a sort of a formal closing, like say goodbye to each other. And then anyone who wants to stay and tell more stories, Angela's for sure offered to stay. Okay. So that those people who need to go can, and those who still want to tell stories still can. Okay. Sound good? Ange, do you want to unmute? And we had an idea.
I still want to hear everybody's story. So Rod and Kate and Callie and everybody else, let's stay, whoever wants to stay. I'm sure a whole bunch of people are going to stay. Most of you have stayed, actually. But for those of you that want to go, Let's just always remember when we're riding our bikes and ringing our bells that that's what Tooker would always tell us to ring our bells. He'd always say, let me hear your bell, just for fun, just for the joy of it. Let's make some noise on our bikes that's beautiful and just rings out into the city. Bikes are here to stay, and bikes are growing, and bikes are beautiful. So I'm going to ring my bell a few times, and let's all remember that. Yeah. And people who need to leave after, you can leave. But thank you all so much for spending this time with me and Shannon and Kelly and everybody that loved and knew Tooker so much. You all did.
Yeah. So much love tonight. So many memories. So much activism. So much impact. So if you brought a bell, or if you just want to use your voice as a bell, go ahead and unmute yourself. And we're going to have the chaos of the Zoom, everybody unmuted, bell ring. So go ahead and unmute.
Ding, 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 ding,
ding, ding, ding, ding, ding. My bell broke. Shit.
And every time we ring our bell, everything that you've said tonight, all those words, right? So we're ringing out for renewables. We're ringing out for bravery. We're ringing out for joy and playfulness. We're ringing out for peace, all of that. So, look at this. You've got your bicycle, Jamie. It's awesome. Yeah. So thank you. If you do need to go, we totally understand. And we're still here listening to the rest of the stories. But thank you. If you do need to go, thank you so much for being here. We love you.